So how does this result help our proof? This is going to help our proof in a very smart way. Remember, we started with a vector lambda. And remember, there are m components of lambda. This is in Rm. And as I said at the beginning, we want to reduce the proof of this lemma 6 to the case when lambda is a rational vector. To reduce something that is real to rational, somehow you can imagine that we are going to use the Diophantine approximation. But we did not apply the Diophantine approximation directly to lambda. Instead, we did a Diophantine approximation of a vector z in capital lambda, which by our hypothesis orthogonal to the vector lambda. And by our Diophantine approximation here, we spent a lot of time talking about this. We concluded that this vector lambda is orthogonal to some integer valued vector t, where this t comes from the Diophantine approximation to z. And now, let's look at the vector lambda component-wise. If we just look at those components over the field of rational numbers, what can you do? A natural approach will be to reduce the set of real numbers lambda 1 through lambda m to a subset of it, mu 1 through mu l, where l is less than or equal to m, such that first, this lambda 1 through lambda m is in the q span of mu 1 through mu l. And second, mu 1 through mu l are linearly independent over q, the field of rational numbers. Therefore, with this reduction, we can write lambda to be equal to the following linear combination, mu 1 times v 1 plus the mu l times VL. With the rational vectors, V1 through VL in QM. This expression might look a little bit weird because we are just looking at it component-wise. For each component of lambda, it can be expressed in terms of mu 1 through mu l, with coefficients rational numbers. And you combine all the components of lambda and all those rational coefficients. This gives you this expression. The result we got above, namely lambda t times little t, the vector little t, is equal to 0, will be equivalent to, let's plug in this relation, This is equivalent to mu1 v1 transpose times t plus the mu l vl transpose times the vector little t equal to 0. Since mu1 through mu l are linearly independent, over Q, Barrel construction, and the coefficients so here those are coefficients bi transpose times t where I is from 1 through L are rational. It follows from this linear independence that Bi transpose times t is equal to 0 for any I greater or equal to 1 less than or equal to L. And I should say that V sub I transpose times t are rational because V sub I's are rational from here, and t is an integer valued vector. So their product must be rational. So, if you look at this absolute value, Vi transpose times z, this is bounded by w times Vi transpose times z. This is true because W is not equal to 0. We make this majorization because we are going to invoke the diffeomanian approximation from here. Remember, this T is not an arbitrarily chosen integer vector. It is associated to this diffeomanian approximation. This guy is actually equal to Vi transpose times Wz. So here I flipped W and V sub I. And now we subtract T from here. This will not change the value of this because we just proved V sub I transpose times T is equal to 0 for any I greater or equal to 1 less than or equal to L. And this guy, if we do a majorization again, is bounded about by the little L1 norm of V sub I times the maximum norm of WZ minus T, and this part is precisely the object for a diffeomanian approximation, which is less than epsilon. And remember, this epsilon is arbitrarily chosen to be less than epsilon 1. Now we can finish this by letting epsilon go to 0. And this will give us that Vi transpose times z equal to 0 for any I greater or equal to 1 and less than or equal to L. And this simply says that Vi transpose times z is equal to 0 for any I greater or equal to 1 less than or equal to L. And with this conclusion, we see the hope of reducing lambda to rational vectors. Now, we are ready to finish the step 1 of our proof. The goal of step 1 is to try to reduce the proof of this lemma to the case when lambda is a rational vector. So now, suppose lemma 6 is proved for the case when lambda is in QM. For general lambda in Rn, such that the hypothesis of the lemma 6 is satisfied. Namely, whenever you have z in lambda whose norm is less than epsilon, with subscript 1, we have lambda transpose z is equal to 0. And we just show that lambda can be written as the following linear combination: mu 1 times v 1 plus dot dot mu l times v l, with v 1 through v l in QM. And moreover, v sub I transpose times z is equal to 0 for any I greater or equal to 1 less than equal to L. Remember, by our assumption, we assume that lemma 6 is already proved for the case when lambda is a rational number. So, if we let V1 through VL, which are in QM, play the role of lambda in lemma 6, and use our assumption in here. By our assumption above, we'll get the conclusion of our lemma 6, which is V sub I is in R span of mu 1 through mu s for any I greater or equal to 1 less than or equal to L. This is precisely our conclusion of lemma 6. Here, V sub I's will play the role of lambda here in the case of rational vectors. So V sub I's will be in span of mu 1 through mu s. And it follows that lambda, which is this linear combination of V sub I's, is in the R span of mu 1 through mu s. So, by assuming lemma 6 proved for the case when lambda is a rational vector, we get the result for the case when lambda is a general vector in Rm. And that is a milestone for our proof. In case our logic here confuses you, let me highlight this part and this part. Hope this is more clear to you now. If we want to VL play the role of lambda in lemma 6 with our additional hypothesis above, that lemma 6 is proved for the case when lambda is a rational number, we'll get the conclusion of lemma 6 for V sub i's. And for this general lambda, which can be expressed in terms of V1 through VL, must be in the R span of U1 through US as well. And this is the end of our step 1 in the proof.